Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Center for Strategic and International Studies. My name is Heather Conley. I'm Senior Fellow and Director of the Europe Program here at CSIS. And I have to say, every once in a while, we do an event that is incredibly timely and topical and relevant, and I cannot think of a more important discussion than we are going to have this morning. We are very pleased to be able to be a launch point for the release of the Trilateral Commission's latest report entitled Engaging Russia, A Return to Containment? And let me give you a few words about the Trilateral Commission. It was formed in 1973 by private citizens of Japan, Europe, and North America to foster closer cooperation among what I would call those G7 countries who were looking for a shared leadership perspective in a wider global international context. Just like in 1973, there was a time of considerable friction between governments, and it was designed for this commission to be private citizens at the highest level to engage on common problems that faced all three regions at a time when it looked as if U.S. leadership could not simply provide the singular answer. So as this group grew, it is now 390 members from Europe, North America, and the Asia-Pacific region. These are leaders from business, the media, academia, public service, non-governmental organizations. It's quite an impressive organization. So today's report, focusing on Russia, is actually the third in a series of reports that the Trilateral Commission has undertaken focusing on Russia since 1995, but this time is different. This time the Trilateral Commission engaged a group of Russian experts to comment on the report that the Commission was offering. So, again, we are incredibly privileged to have four very distinguished colleagues who were very instrumental in co-drafting the particular chapters for this new report. And what I'd like to do is very briefly introduce them. This is the order that they will speak. And then we've saved a real treat to have Dr. Brzezinski provide some commentary. So let me begin and introduce Paula Dobriansky, who is Senior Fellow at Harvard University's John F. Kennedy Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs, and current chair of the National Board of Directors of the World Affairs Council of America. Formerly, Paula was the Undersecretary of State for Global Affairs at the State Department from 2001 to 2009, and Paula was one of the principal writers of the North American contribution to the report. And the second speaker will be Dr. Igor Yurgens, who, again, led the group of Russians that provided comments on the report. Dr. Yurgens is chairman of the Management Board of the Institute of Contemporary Development in Moscow. He's also a member of the Presidential Council for Civil Society Institutions and Human Rights, among many other distinguished titles. And then we turn to, I'll get my papers right here, we turn to Minister Andrzej Olechowski, who is the chairman of the Polish group in the Trilateral Commission, also a former Minister of Foreign Affairs of Poland from 1993 to 1995, and a former Minister of Finance from 1992. He currently serves as chairman of the Supervisory Board of Bank Hilaudi. And finally, we have former Japanese Deputy Foreign Minister Shotaro Oshima, who is currently the chairman of the Institute for International Economic Studies, former Japanese ambassador to Korea, and we are delighted that he will provide the Asian Pacific concept and perspective. And then after our speakers are finished, we'll turn to Dr. Zbigniew Brzezinski, CSIS counselor and trustee, and also co-chair of the CSIS Advisory Board. Dr. Brzezinski is not part of the Trilateral Commission, although he was at one time a director of the Trilateral Commission from 1973 to 1976. Dr. Brzezinski is going to provide some reflections on the comments of our speakers and putting this this into some greater context. As I said, we couldn't have a better group of speakers to help us understand the future policy towards Russia. And with that, I'll welcome Paula to begin. And again, thank you for joining us.
Phone is on. Yes, it is. Good morning to all of you. And first, thank you to CSIS and to you in particular, Heather, as the director of the Europe program. We're very, very appreciative of being here this morning. I'd like to make a few brief comments about the North America chapter and some of its findings. Let me go right to the core recommendation that we put forward, and that is that there is a need to have a fundamental reassessment of all aspects of U.S. relations with Russia. And in this context, certainly it's important in the short term to be thinking about how we need to consider what our response to Russia's aggression in Crimea and in Ukraine, how that's going to affect regional issues and also U.S. vital interests abroad. In sum, on this point, basically there are two key aspects. One is not only the regional considerations that are before us, which are absolutely essential that need to be considered and what the ramifications are for what we have witnessed in terms of Russia's actions, but secondly, the global ramifications. And let me give you two examples of the global ramifications. One is the Budapest Memorandum of 1994, of which the United States, the UK, and Russia signed. And basically, it called upon Ukraine to give up its nuclear weapons. At that time, Ukraine was, in fact, the third largest nuclear power, but in return for a protection of its territorial integrity and its sovereignty. So why I put this before you in the particular, it raises the question for those who care about nonproliferation in terms of the validity and the importance of such agreements. If you're in other parts of the world, in the Middle East, or you're in Asia, that question definitely is going to come before the minds of many. There's also the broader point, which is, and I've already suggested by giving this one example, is the question of legal norms and the international order as we know it. Certainly post-World War II, when we think about the various architectures that have been set forth and parameters and international legal order as we know it, that has been disrupted. And that will have direct ramifications, as we've seen, for peace and for stability. And so the core point, our core recommendation, it is absolutely essential for policymakers to step back and to very specifically to have a fundamental reassessment of all aspects of our policy toward Russia. Let me go to a second point of our report. And that concerns the issue of what are the premises that matter in assessing Russia today. There are many that one could cite, and I'm not going to enumerate all that are cited in the report, but I will pick out a few. One is a term and a phenomenon that we cite, which is that of Putinism, as we call it, a phenomenon that we believe has significantly influenced our relations. His assumptions, worldview, ideas, basically have become an important factor, an important political force in Russia. And clearly, in this regard, it's an important factor in our strained relationship. How does one define it? Well, it is highly personal, it's vertical. It also is grounded in what constitutes very staunch nationalism, populism, social conservatism, as well as also anti-Americanism that we have witnessed. So this is, I think, an important element. There were other elements that we also cited in our report in terms of findings, questions relevant to the human rights situation and the kind of erosion of democratic institutions, rule of law, issues also related to the economy, the challenges of corruption, also the issue of demographics, also, which certainly has bearing on Russia. The 20th year straight of a natural population decrease, when you even look at Russian statistics in this regard, in terms of what is found, there are concerns about what will happen with the population going forward. But let me come back to this core point about Putinism, because it's very relevant here. One thing that has united U.S. administrations, when you look at it starting with Reagan and you go on up to the present time with President Obama, whether it's a Republican or a Democratic administration, all of these administrations have been united by a policy of the construct of a Europe whole and free. At the time, even Gorbachev used the term of embracing a common European home. In this case, there's a distinction here in terms of President Putin's statements and in terms of the question of values and a disassociation of this embracement of Western values and rather the construct of a Eurasian Union and not, as Gorbachev put it, a common European home. Let me go to a third point that we had, and that is about Russia's foreign policy. On Russia's foreign policy, we've categorized it as an extension of domestic politics. Here, basically, when you look at also President Putin's statements, he has cited foreign dangers. Foreign dangers, in fact, to justify a consolidation of power at home. There have been a variety of issues. We've seen clearly in the case with Ukraine, in terms of his ratings last year and his ratings now, they've gone up from some 63% previously now to some 80%. Basically here, in terms of foreign policy, there's also the issue of the creation of a geopolitical and geoeconomic demand, if you will, for Russia. And here the creation of a kind of sphere, a sphere of states that are united in terms of their values, and it's a post-Soviet sphere. And this is where Ukraine certainly comes into play and is a very important factor in that. Let me mention the fourth point is the issue of energy. We had a very robust discussion about energy, and with the events of a recent time, the annexation, the unlawful annexation of Crimea, and the aggression in Ukraine, this has become a more critical issue and has been very extensively under discussion. I would say that this issue does matter in terms of our overall calculation. Energy does provide nearly 20% of Russia's GDP and also over half of its federal government revenue. We also know the dependency of Europe and the interrelationships here. So this is definitely an area that has to be part of this discourse. I will say in conclusion, and keeping it brief, with brief comments and conversational comments right up front, in conclusion, I'd say the underpinning for the North America group is that what is going on and what happens in Ukraine and the Russian policies, it has, again, not only regional ramifications, but certainly global ramifications. What we do now is being scrutinized, and it is being scrutinized by other kinds of circumstances across the globe and other leaders who are looking at what is done here and what it could mean for other areas. I think that also we are witnessing President Putin striving to redress what he deemed to be the most significant geostrategic loss of the 21st century, the dismantlement of the Soviet Union. And in this regard, the question comes back to what do we do? I was struck by a piece written by a journalist, Ann Applebaum, in the Washington Post. She was talking about how for 20 years, nobody actually discussed the issue of, or really thought about, the issue of how to contain Russia. And she concluded her piece by saying, now they will. And I would say that as part of a reassessment, I think all of these issues are certainly on the table. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and it's a great honor and a unique opportunity because Russians for the first time are invited, first of all, to comment on the trilateral report, second, to participate in the work of the trilateral, and third of all, to create a chapter, Russian chapter in the trilateral, which would be unheard of in the Soviet Union or even at the beginning of post-Soviet period. So we formed up a chapter, almost. We will be attending this trilateral as already a group, and I think that we will contribute to the common work. A few words about our contribution to the report. What are the main ideas? The main idea, number one, is of course to stop at Crimea and not to go further. Then abide by Geneva agreements, and we're proud that we were in our report, in our little position paper, we were ahead of intergovernmental agreement to form up a contact group in Geneva by 3 weeks or so, and we didn't have any contact with Russian authorities on that. So we called for the creation of the contact group. It was created. Geneva Agreement was a first step, though timid one, in being reconsidered now at the moment. At this particular moment, people are quarreling again within and outside of this group. But we think that the basic principles of Geneva Group are sound principles for the crisis resolution. Then we called on the Russian side to make a very thorough assessment of the world system and the economic implications of both sanctions and its present economic policies. The Russian economy slowed down to 1% and probably this year to -1%, not because of the sanctions, but because of the economic situation both inside the country, in Europe, and in our own non-diversified economy. So we are calling for a very thorough analysis of what should be done and can Russia sustain its growth in the sanctioned world, so to say. There are illusions about China and other potential allies, but those are illusions because Russian economy, which faces the deficit of labor, the deficit of technology, and the deficit of capital, cannot rely on third-tier technologies, second-quality labor, and all of that stuff. So we have to be part of the global world, which would be impossible if we continue the policies which call for sanctions. And number four proposal is, of course, to we understand that G8 is no more, but G8 track two, NGOs contacts, Human Rights Watchers contacts, the contacts between scientific, academic, student communities should be kept intact and should be developed further. We think that trilateral and Russian chapter could be one of those instruments and channels, and we think that the people who join us are of high caliber intellectually and societally, and they can contribute to that. My last point would be, is West totally immune, and or is West a knight in the shining armor in all of these conflicts? Did West contribute to what happened in Ukraine, or is it absolutely blameless? I think it's not. And historically, I can tell you, in the presence of Mr. Brzezinski, who in Munich conference, which I attended also, rightly said that the situation can only be solved through compromise, and then wrote his famous article about Finlandization of Ukraine, which made some Finns mad, but was right in the substance. So in his presence, I would like to say that the conflict, this particular one, of course, it's a chain of many conservative developments in Russian domestic policies, no question about that. And probably during the Q&A, I can elaborate on that. But at this particular moment, I can tell you that the chain of this events were created by the so-called Eastern Partnership in 2007. European Union decided that it will help Ukraine, Georgia, Moldova, Belarus, Armenia, and Georgia to build up new societies. It didn't invite Russia to participate. It earmarked and spent between 2007 and 2013 less than $4 billion to do this. And Russia in the same period spent in the same countries about 20 times more. And there were no correlation, there were no coordination, they will not talk about that. And when I asked one of the ambassadors of the European Union, why can't we join forces, the answer was, it's not in the books. We do not discuss such partnership with the third parties. Same happened with Ukraine, associate agreement. When it was obvious that Yanukovych cannot sign this associate agreement because he lacks money to do that, and he ran to Putin, and Putin says, okay, I'll buy Ukrainian bonds, $50 billion worth, and immediately bought $3 billion, et cetera, et cetera. Lavrov went back to Ashton, European Union commissars, asking to make it trilateral. Let's talk, he said, about Ukrainian situation because it's, they are in such dire straits, in such difficult economic situation that without us, European Union and Ukrainians, without such triangles, we will not be able to solve Ukrainian problems. The answer was no, we will not discuss it with the third parties. And then again, I asked informally one of the colleagues in Brussels, and he says, unfortunately, even those who sympathize with the opposition cannot do that because it has to be renegotiated because there is a format of our associate membership agreements, and third parties, especially Russia, out of bounds. So does that mean the West is farsighted in this situation? No blames, no things to think about in the future? I think it's not true. We have to think about trilateral, quadruple, or whatever cooperation on Ukraine, because even if we solve the problem now, Let's think that we have a magic button and we strike it and tomorrow there is peace in terms of security and political settlement. The most difficult part begins because the Ukrainian is, have no budget, they owe to the outside world more than $40 billion, they have no capital to start growing, they have a lot of difficulties to rebuild its institutions, and with all my sympathy to those young people who decided that they would be a kamikaze, as they said themselves said, running this parliament, running this government, they have to have some money, which can only come from European Union, United States, and Russia. Russia through gas and other subsidies, European Union institution building plus money, United States has to contribute something apart from $1 billion worth of guarantees. Listen, it's not only a peanuts, it's ridiculous. I understand that American position is being elaborated now, and I agree with Paula that total reassessment will not only help American administration and their allies, it will help us to react accordingly, because at the moment, the message which Russians are receiving, Russian leadership is very confused. Some in the European Union don't want sanctions at all, and behind the back saying, everything will come down. Don't you worry, we will strike a deal. The CEOs of the biggest European companies come and negotiate good deals and ask Mr. Putin to be a friendly hand in administrative layer, so to say. Chinese support, by and large, they contributed their report to trilateral. They support the Russian position. Indians don't want to be behind Chinese because they need us to rebalance the situation there in China, and so on and so forth. So reassessment and strong position and one voice of the West, if it's possible, will help us to reassess the position and to give policy advice to Kremlin, because otherwise they will play on divide and rule sort of a kind of situation. So I will end up here, and I'm, of course, I would be more than happy to answer the questions if I can.
Thank you, Dr. Yurgens. Minister.
Well, I want to join the other speakers in thanking for this invitation. I need to mention, however, that the price is heavy, because to speak about Russia and Ukraine in the presence of Dr. Brzezinski is a very stressful exercise.
Welcome to my world.
I want to congratulate you also for the new building. Very impressive, and one can see also comfortable for the staff and the guests. I will not try to summarize the views, European views on Russia. These are the views of the continent, which is famous for its variety, slow food and slow decision making. So summarizing it is quite impossible. But I wanted to mention three issues, three points that emerge as the eras of consensus in Europe and as the eras for necessitating action. The first is give Ukraine a chance to sort out from the collapse of the governance and of its economy. And giving the chance means to insulate Ukraine to the extent possible from external pressure and external blackmail. And also helping Ukraine in genuine efforts to improve its economic situation. The beginning for those efforts will come with the beginning of the IMF program, which will succeed only if it is supported generously and patiently by the West, but also by Russia. If Russia decides to sabotage this, this program, Ukraine will have very hard time to implement it. My second point is that nowadays, contagion spreads wide and very fast, as we know, not only in finance, in politics as well. If not contained, the illegal annexation of Crimea will have grave consequences for the EU. Firstly, international law is of key importance for the EU. The EU only exists because there is an assumption that international treaties will be respected in all circumstances. EU has no other means of governing than through the law. No other force can be used. So if illegal annexation of Crimea was accepted or tolerated, that would undermine the rule of law in Europe and would result in more Ukrainians in the future. But also, secondly, there are many places in Europe where people say, why should I be minority in your country if you can be minority in mine? There's plenty of places like that. So if one tolerates actions like Crimea, one, of course, encourages nationalistic elements in nationalistic parties, right-wing parties, around Europe, East and West. And we see it already. Hungarian Jobbik made some statements about that, that they do support Crimea and they want to claim some Hungarian territories. And in many countries, acceptance of illegal annexation of Crimea would encourage that kind of ideas and that kind of aspirations. Now, my third point is that sanctions are necessary, but sanctions are not substitute for a strategy. Europe has to deal with a new reality, which is that Russia is not cooperative, that Russia presents itself as a rival who wants to actively work against European values and European interests. And that has to be, that situation has to be adjusted to. The EU certainly should draw red lines for future Russian actions. Certainly, EU should increase its defense capacity. Certainly, EU should enhance its independence from Russia in energy and trade. Certainly, also, EU should make sure that Russia doesn't draw benefits from European integration using European institutions and so on, which were created, which we are all benefiting from. However, European Union and Russia are in many ways complementary, and they both need each other. So long term, this is unsustainable. Long term, we shouldn't be accepting the idea that that continent will remain permanently divided. This is too a depressing perspective to resign to. So we need, and that has been mentioned by Igor and others, certainly strengthen public diplomacy, build bridges to ordinary Russians and civic society and the next generation of public, of policymakers. But we also need to do something that we failed to do in the past. That is to design a place for Russia in European architecture that would be satisfying for Russians and useful for Europe. That has been a big failure, as I said, in the past, that we were unable to do that. To arrive to that, though, we have to find common voice on Russia, common view on Russia, which we don't have yet because we are slow food, slow decision making, and very varied continent. But as long as we don't have, for as long as we don't have such a concept, there is we are unable to offer a serious strategic debate to Russia, and Russia is, as we see, unable to think of itself differently than as a separate power without allies and without long-term commitments. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Mr. Oshima.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to join myself with the previous speakers in thanking the CSIS for this meeting and also express my feelings of a great honor being with Dr. Brzezinski. I am in a little bit of a complicated situation because I'm supposed to be sharing with you some of the ideas of the Asian Pacific group, which is so diverse and there's no one unified voice coming out of the whole process yet, and I don't think it will be anytime soon. But there was a certain amount of coordination between Japanese, Korean, some of the Southeast Asian members of the group. So that can be represented a little bit in the whole process. And then, of course, at some point, perhaps I need to share with you where Japan stands, being from Japan. And I may have to say a few things totally from a personal point of view. Having said that, most striking factor that I would like to stress when we talk about the Asian Pacific angle is that as you see it on the map, Asia is a vast region, has so many different countries, and therefore each of these countries have had a very different relationship with Russia or the Soviet Union, whenever you take in terms of history. So they have totally different perspectives, even now, with respect to what's happening in Russia, what is happening in Ukraine. But I think we can say at the outset that there is one point which we in Asia are concerned about, and what has to do with the points already raised, and that is the fact that the recent events do go against the basic principles of international law, UN Charter, by using force or threat thereof to change territorial borders, which is inimical to our interest, our army interest, meaning members of the international community, including those of us in East Asia. Now, but from a very East Asian angle, there are other interesting angles, sometimes not mentioned by others, because of this fact that this is an East Asian angle. And that is, this is not a coordinated position, but it could have a demonstration effect. There are other members of the international community who sometimes stress the importance of nationalistic emotions and stoke it in order to proceed with international policies, sometimes coming close to irredentism. So we were a bit concerned about what kind of impact the Russian actions in Ukraine would have in that respect. And there's also another interesting angle for us in East Asia is that U.S., which has been a very much of a stabilizing force in East Asia, Western Pacific, and which has recently introduced this notion of Asian pivot, stress on rebalancing, may be distracted by what is happening in Europe on the European theater. With this kind of a demonstration effect, if you will, somebody used this from Asia, this notion, and distraction on the part of the United States, which are all very much much of a concern. There's another angle, mostly Japanese angle, having had difficult, to be honest, relationship with Soviet Union over, for many, many years, even before the war and during the war and after during the Cold War times. We are very happy to see new Russia emerging out of the collapse of the Soviet Union. And we are seeing Russia as a stabilizing force in the global affairs, but also in East Asia. Now we are not quite sure where Russia is heading because of the fact that they defy the basic rules of international relations, submitting itself to the principles of territorial integrity and whatnot. So even from the East Asian angle, or at least from the Japanese angle, the situation is has reverberations, very much so, a very deep one, and which is very disconcerting. Now, at the end, what we are doing in Japan, of course, aside from these basic concerns I mentioned, we are in close cooperation with the G7 countries, we are, at the end of the day, we are hoping for a diplomatic resolution of the situation. So therefore, we have been supporting of the Geneva Agreement. I hope that this will be implemented through peaceful means. And aside from these political sides, we are also concerned about the economic situation in Ukraine that was already mentioned. So we will be joining forces with other G7 member countries in providing economic assistance. We have already committed 1.5 billion. Even from the eastern end of the Eurasian continent, we are very much concerned about what's happening in Ukraine. And that would be my comments. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Dr. Brzezinski.
Thank you very much for having me here. Let me start by simply saying that I view what is happening today in the relationship between Ukraine and Russia, and in the larger perspective between the West and the East, and specifically the United States and Russia, as a very serious development, which poses the risk that we will be somebody obviously wants to listen to a concert. I fear that we are in effect stumbling into a serious crisis which is somewhat unpredictable, but one which does involve, at least on the part of one side, the explicit use of force. Explicit use of force. I have no way of knowing how the Russian leadership was assessing its actions regarding Crimea and what its risk analysis was. But it's quite clear from the manner in which it was undertaken that the action contemplated the possibility of some explosion, some use of force, and therefore retained for itself the option of deniability. The Russian military, the Spetsnaz that went in, were camouflaged in a variety of dramatic ways. But it was the Ukrainians who refrained from shooting and in effect surrendered that made this action peaceful and successful at the same time. That's a good combination, but it's also a dangerous combination. Peaceful, fine, but if successful, then it's tempting. And therefore, there is the risk that what we may see subsequently in the foreseeable near future is the expansion of such tactics involving a more direct collision between Russia and Ukraine and externally between Russia and the United States. That is obviously to be avoided. But one also has to look at its deeper sources. And while Western policy has not been faultless, and some of the preceding speakers have alluded to that, including our colleague from Russia, the fact is that there has been a significant change in Russia in the last several years, away from a democratic evolution, which was underway, and which, when Medvedev was president, seemed hopeful and possible, but which has been retracted gradually, step by step, but increasingly clearly in recent times, involving not only a turn away from democracy as a near-term prospect for Russia, but for increasing emphasis on a kind of chauvinistic nationalism, which was well expressed in the speeches by Mr. Putin in the middle of March as the operation in Crimea was being consummated. It was a remarkable statement in which Russia assumed the right to use physical force to protect any Russians living outside of Russia. And of course, that does not apply to the risk that some Russians living in Paraguay may be faced by Russian military intervention. But it does apply very directly to some countries that neighbor on Russia and recovered its independence from Russia relatively recently, though peacefully. And that is a serious problem. It also is a problem which is strangely one-sided, because Russia currently has 145 million people, of whom approximately 20 to 25 million are not Russians. Suppose the reverse of that doctrine was to be pursued. What would it imply? In other words, we're dealing here with a Pandora's box, which, if opened, would become increasingly difficult and dangerous. In the meantime, of course, the United States is getting drawn in, and pressures are rising for a more visible assertion of the American position on this subject. I think that raises serious and very difficult issues. I don't anticipate they can be resolved dramatically and in their totality. For example, I think Mr. Putin's commitment to the Eurasian Union is a very real one, and it stems from his openly proclaimed regret that the Soviet Union fell apart. But it is also, incidentally, encountering more serious opposition from its would-be candidates. Just look at who supported Russia in the UN vote. Armenia, because of geopolitical concerns, it is dependent on Russian support, as well as historically its support, and Belarus. None of the other would-be candidates for the Eurasian Union, not a single one of them, voted with Russia. And some of them have become increasingly explicit in their reservations about the notion of the Union. President Nazarbayev of Kazakhstan, for example, has emphatically emphasized the term Eurasian Economic Union, and referring here to the free trade arrangements that could be contrived, and indeed they could be on an individual basis with the different former Soviet republics. But that dream is part of the dream that the president of Russia currently entertains, and he does it with means that give rise to serious concern. Camouflaged use of force and threats, for example, that if the gradually self-defining Ukrainian government, which confronts enormous internal difficulties, is to use some form of compulsion to reestablish its authority over territories seized allegedly by Ukrainian citizens or Russian speakers of Ukraine, but in fact with visible support of the same instruments of violence that were injected into Crimea, but did not have to be used as instruments of violence, we may see a collision that is becoming more and more dangerous. And that concerns me, obviously, because at stake, of course, is international stability, precedence for the use of force, commitments, and the likelihood that misunderstandings will deepen, accusations will become sharper, and the room for accommodation increasingly tenuous. I still think, however, that there is a residual chance for seeking some accommodation. And I hearken back to the ideas that I've been articulating since the Verkunde meeting in Germany in late winter of this year, namely, that there should be some arrangement contrived regarding a special status for a self-governing, self-defining, increasingly democratic Ukraine that wants to be part of a democratic Europe without any likelihood that in the near future it will be a direct member of the European Union. Turkey has been moving towards Europe over the last 50 years, step by step. So it's a long process. But the desire to be part of Europe, and particularly to adapt its political, socio-economic institutions to Ukraine, is pervasive in Ukraine. And it cannot be denied by some dubious claims of an ethnically based right to intervene by force in Ukrainian affairs. On the other hand, it is perfectly reasonable for Russia to object to Ukrainian membership in NATO. And I think it is perfectly reasonable for us to say to the Russians, instead of sliding into a conflict, which could become a conflict of arms, a little bit maybe on the model of the Spanish Civil War, where external countries were helping one or the other of the two parties in that civil war, and we would certainly be not immune to public pressures to help the Ukrainians resist, if they resist, and if they don't have an army that can go into the field to match the Russian army that enters, they do have cities with strongly nationalistic young people in it who like being independent and who want to be in Europe. And taking cities by force is a prolonged, painful, and bloody affair. And Russia is no condition to engage in it. Yes. Something like Crimea is feasible. Something like Crimea on the Ukrainian scale, if it were feasible, Russia could afford. But the prolonged draining conflict, especially if supported against Russia from the outside, would really destroy the currently very tenuous process of transforming Russia, modernizing it, and turning it into an entity that can then evolve successfully into democracy. I would favor an effort to convince the Russians that that kind of a status for Ukraine could be beneficial to Russia. And Russia itself could be a party to the process of putting Ukraine on its feet. That would be in Russia's own interest. The government that it supported in Ukraine under Yanukovych was probably one of the most kleptocratic governments in the history of modern times, on a scale unprecedented, draining a potentially rich country of any of its residual wealth or prospects. But there remains in Ukraine, and in eastern Ukraine, a strong industrial base from which Russia benefits itself. For example, Russian aviation industry is heavily based on aircraft engines produced by Ukraine. Russia still buys rockets from Ukraine. In other words, the opportunities for a transactional three-way relationship do exist, and one should explore that, in my view. It may not work, but I think it is important to invoke the possibility of an accommodation and to point to its benefits. Because in the absence of that, the dynamics and the emotions involved here could become self-sustaining. Mr. Putin has unleashed a form of nationalistic chauvinism in his recent public statements for which there is some strong social support in Russia from the sort of less successful elements of Russian society, for the more primitive elements of Russian society. And they confront potentially in Russia an alternative, the new middle class, which is cosmopolitan, which is European, which is creative, which wants to be like the West, and is prepared to be a democracy. I think the future is theirs, provided we do not succumb to passive fatalism, which lets events drive us and then embroil us into tragedy, which will damage Russia much more than us, but will hurt all of us collectively. So that is my central message to my former colleagues at the Trilateral Commission. I hope they spend some time on considering that option rather than debating the pros and cons of a situation which shouldn't have arisen, which doesn't deserve to be tolerated, which is extremely one-sided and very emotional, but collectively self-destructive. Thank you.
Dr. Brzezinski, thank you so much. Thank you to you all. What a powerful and rich discussion. While our audience is absorbing that richness, and I hope everyone's starting to think their own questions, I'd like to just throw one or two questions out to our panelists, and then I will turn this over to our audience. If you do have a question, when we get to that point, please raise your hand, wait for a microphone to come. Sometimes you have to speak very directly into that microphone for our colleagues to hear you. Please state your name and affiliation, and we like our questions short and provocative. So with that, Paula, if I, a bit of clarification, I'm sure our audience is quite interested. When can we see this report? When are we going to have an opportunity to review it? So if you could just provide us with a bit of an understanding of the product and when it will be coming out and how colleagues can access it, that would be terrific. So that's my first sort of good housekeeping question to you. Dr. Yurgens, you made a very focused point about the lost opportunity on a new architecture. And as you were talking, not only the Eastern Partnership, but I was thinking of the Corfu process. And at then time, President Medvedev had offered sort of a new European security architecture. And our problem with this new architecture is we're not always convinced that Moscow wants to support the process rather than diminish it or be, as we like to say, a skunk at the picnic, not providing the accommodation. And I would like your reflections on what that new architecture looks like, and can that possibly happen under President Putin? I have my serious doubts that Putinism and a new accommodative architecture is possible. And then finally, and all colleagues can comment on this, but pulling on Dr. Brzezinski's point on expansion, understandably, we are very focused on Ukraine at the moment and the very serious crisis. But to be clear, we have Moldova and Georgia that have their own European aspirations. They have territorial challenges, Transnistria, South Ossetia, Georgia. That we still have in June a signing of the association agreement and the deep and comprehensive free trade agreement. We're going to be back at this again and again. And how do we reflect on the neighborhood, not just Ukraine? Obviously, Ukraine is pivotal here, but there are others. And I would welcome colleagues' reflection as we look towards June and other monumentous events. So I hope you got you some time. Get your questions going. Paula, please.
Thank you. I'm actually very glad you asked that question because to put this report in context, we began last year in the summertime, approximately, and at that time, each of us, North America, Russia, Europe, Asia, Pacific, We had brought together experts. So let me just give a quick thumbnail. North America brought together a wide range of experts in the field and representing different perspectives. We met twice, and in which we were debating the content of a first draft. We also had the occasion to also meet with the business community. A part of our report also integrates specifically the perspective of those doing business in Russia. So the meetings all last year were focused on this. We also, in the context of the Trilateral Commission, we each have regional meetings. So we had our North America meeting in Mexico City. And on the occasion of that, we also had Canadian and Mexican views integrated into this process. I won't itemize, but each area did comparable things. Then this year, we met the four of us in March. And it was very clear that before us, there was a very changed situation with the annexation of Crimea and also with the troops amassed on the Ukrainian border. So we discussed the need to go back to the drawing board, so this answers your question, revamp our chapters, which we did. We've updated them and also summarized them. As to when it gets released, we've actually been discussing this, and I'm giving my perspective of the four. I think that what we have is quite relevant, and I think that at least a goal I see is an issuance into early May. We'd like to have this for policymakers, and I think the value of this, as you could see, each of us don't have precisely the same recommendations, but policymakers will have the great value of being able to look and assess for themselves, well, these are the views of North America. This is the compilation of European views, Russian views, and no less Asia Pacific. So in sum, our goal is soon, and I think it's certainly mandated by a great interest in the topic and also the desire for policy input.
Thank you. Lost opportunities, there were plenty, starting with Gorbachev's common European home. And then you mentioned Corfu process, which was the follow-up of the Medvedev's then president proposal to conclude a new security treaty in Europe. It was immediately treated as an attempt of Russians to divide NATO and to push United States out of Europe, which was not at least in our view, those who were involved, the main idea. The main idea was to, after Kosovo and everything which happened on the continent after the collapse of the Soviet Union, to present new picture of how Helsinki 2, if you wish, or Helsinki 3 would work. So there were lost opportunities. At the moment, your direct question is whether accommodative architecture is possible. This is not the right moment to start any kind of a negotiation on that. But definitely, one of these days, we'll come back to the idea and we will start talking about this. And people remember that after Cuban crisis, we had salt agreement in 3-4 years. Nobody could have thought after the Cuban crisis, which brought us to the threshold of the term of nuclear war, that we will be able to do that. We were. And then after Russian invasion of Czechoslovakia, Soviet invasion in Czechoslovakia in 1968, in 1972 we had a text of the Helsinki Agreement. So never say never, and the future probably could be bright. And I applaud the proposal of Mr. Brzezinski to think positive, but to keep all alternatives open. We'll see what happens, and I hope that we'll contribute in our small and modest way.
About a week from now, Poland will celebrate its 10th anniversary of its membership in European Union. It's also 15th anniversary of our membership in NATO. 10 years ago, we had a trilateral meeting in Warsaw where Dr. Brzezinski had a keynote presentation, and he saw a good future for Europe However, with two conditions. One, that Russia, as he said, will not be distracted by its imperial ambitions. And secondly, assuming that the process of further extension of EU and NATO will go ahead. It didn't go ahead. Eastern policy was the first policy of European Union directed to Eastern Europe. It is only then that European Union recognized that Eastern Europe is in its a sphere of interest, and it should be somehow worked with. It's amazing that it took so long, but you know what you hear about fatigue and political dynamics and lack of interest of political leaders in that issue is behind it. This is a little bit long answer to what you've asked, but specifically the process with Georgia and Moldova, it goes according to established calendar. How it's going to end up, who knows? You know what happens in Moldova. Georgia is slightly different. All our projects, all our ambitions are now up in the air. Eastern partnership policy is subject to criticism, revision, probably quite fundamental. The whole policy towards Eastern Europe, Russia, and so on is being rethought. So. I can't answer it truly.
Thank you. Just a couple of comments. It's very interesting to learn from our European North American colleagues about how we should proceed from here and now. On basis of what has been happening over the past decades in Europe. But one point I would like to emphasize from a different perspective of my part of the world is that, to my understanding, the global situation has changed so much over the past decade or two from the ones we have been used to. Immediately after the war, throughout the Cold War years, where Europe, US-Soviet relations were, Soviet, the West relationship was predominant, which was the axis of all of the international order. Now the situation is changing. So whatever is going to happen in the European region with all the issues being mentioned here from this table will have to be sort of reassessed in the new global situation, power balance, if you will, on the ground. You have to input the fact, the point I mentioned earlier, that the Americans are now pursuing the pivot to Asia. Why was this necessary? Without having that element included in the policies to be followed in the European region, it would not be a sustainable and effective. Thank you very much.
And it was very good, so you don't need to. Absolutely, no, thank you, but I just want to make sure you want to chime in. So we're going to do a flash round of questions. So we'll take several and bundle them up. So if you could raise your hand, great. I see one right in the back, please, sir, right there. We'll get a microphone to you.
Thank you very much. My name is Miomir Zuzul. I work here with Patton Box, but I'm former Minister of Foreign Affairs of Croatia. And I really thank you for a very thoughtful and very great insight in what's going on. I am afraid that I share rather a pessimistic picture that was so clearly presented by Dr. Brzezinski. And I am surprised with the only one fact that we should be surprised, and that is that the world is surprised with what's going on, because there is nothing in Putin's politics that should surprise us. It is quite clear, and it was quite possible to recognize in what direction is going for several years now. I have two questions. One is related to organization that I think contributed significantly to stability in Europe in past time and can contribute again, but was mentioned only once today, and that is NATO. I'm afraid that marginalization of NATO that it is happening is not helping to the situation. Like, for example, as Minister from Poland said very correctly, kind of path was established with all new member of EU countries first to enter the NATO and after a while to enter the European Union. Although that was never a formal decision, that was the reality, which I think was very good reality. When they consider instant policy of European Union, nobody was really thinking about that, so there was a confusion of those two things. In European Union, even in this moment, they are talking about strengthening joint European forces, although clearly there is no time to do that and to have forces that can be not instrumental, but positive. And when we look into the newest development that we have new Secretary General of NATO elected, that in no Western media there is a reflection of that, that we don't know, except for those who are very closely following what is his agenda, potential agenda. It's a former Norwegian Prime Minister Stoltenberg, but in the same time we have Mr. Putin, who doesn't do anything accidentally, came publicly and said that that was very, very good choice by NATO, and then the new Secretary General of NATO is almost good friend of him. So that's one question that I have for particularly Dr. Brzezinski, but actually for all members of panel, what is with the role of NATO? And the second, in her excellent analysis, Paula mentioned as a number four factor, and that is the energy. And it is quite clear that the energy is the strongest instrument in the hands of Mr. Putin right now, not only because that makes Russian economy solid and relatively strong, but also it is the instrument by which he is basically influencing the rest of the Europe to do or not to do what he doesn't want them to do. So we could see several days ago response of President Medvedev, who was basically sending the message to all European leaders, if you really believe that American gas will come in time to help you for the next winter, then you are very naive. We could see the pressure from the President of European Commission, Mr. Barroso, to Bulgaria to stop with the South Stream and to strengthen suddenly again TAP pipeline, but that is way, way too slow. So my question is there any way really to make Europe, particularly Europe, less independent from Russian gas and Russian energy, because unless that happens, I do not believe in any possibility to stop Mr. Putin.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. We have a question right here.
I'll be brief. I had the honor to take Dr. Brzezinski's course at Harvard when he was pushing 30, and I was pushing about 12, I guess, or whatever. But I think he's aged a bit. He's looking closer to 40 now. My question really is one that has not been addressed by anybody, and that is, what do you think the role of religion is in this whole area? As I understand it, Western Ukraine looks to Rome, and Eastern Ukraine looks to Moscow, culturally, religiously, and in other ways. Do you see, and Dr. Brzezinski certainly had some practice in dealing with colleagues. The Polish Pope was about to be Saint someone or other in a couple of days. I'm wondering whether you can see any possibility of cultural stroke religious interests helping to resolve this issue.
Thank you very much, Heather. I'll do my best to be provocative and also concise. My name is Edward Joseph. I'm from across the street at Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies. And a first brief congratulations to the Commission for the very far-sighted decision to include Russia in the process of drafting this report, quite wise. And indeed, my question is for Dr. Yurgens. Both you and Ambassador Dobriansky called for a reassessment. And as you're probably aware and no doubt encouraged, Dr. Yurgens, some in this country have taken the occasion of the crisis in Ukraine to reassess the wisdom of NATO expansion. So my question for you, I have a very pointed question for you, and that is, how has NATO expansion imperiled Russian security? Not Russian hegemonic pretensions, not Russia's ability to dictate the strategic orientation of its neighbors, but its security interests. And of course, as Dr. Brzezinski mentioned, at the core of these is at least the putative claim about imperiled ethnic Russians. So how has the Baltic states, by virtue of being in NATO, how are their rights, and being in the EU as well, I should mention, how are their rights being imperiled? Has Lithuania taken advantage of its NATO membership to block Russian access to Kaliningrad? Overall, have the relations of these new NATO entrants been belligerent towards Russia? Or, to the contrary, Poland, Baltic states, the others, actually demonstrated that the relations with Russia are much more predictable and even productive as a result of being in the alliance. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ed. I want to make sure we get over here. We have one colleague right there in the back. Yeah. Oh, no, no, right there. Stop. Right.
I sort of have a unrelated or twofold question. I look at this from an economic standpoint.
Could you identify yourself?
Yes, my name is Ken Duckworth. I'm with the U.S. Department of Commerce Office of Russia. I was recently our trade attaché in St. Petersburg. The first side of this is Dr. Brzezinski's proposal for sort of a transactional relationship that Russia can benefit. One of the problems I seem to run into when I was in Russia for the last 4 years is not a mindset that sees any issue as anything other than zero sum. And how do you sort of get, what could influence Mr. Putin and his other people around him to see anything other than them trying to gain an advantage over other and seeing that there is there are mutually beneficial benefits to be obtained from the type of relationship that Mr. Brzezinski proposes. Secondly, in terms of thinking about how we go about implementing or not implementing sanctions, you know, even though the U.S. volume of trade with Russia is exceedingly small compared to Europe, we have some pretty companies with pretty significant investments in the Russian Federation, and I'm talking specifically in the oil and gas sector and the natural resources area, whose business interests are going to run up against our national interest or what we're trying to achieve, and how do we balance off what it is they're trying to do versus sort of the bigger picture?
Well, they were wonderful questions. I think I'm going to give our panelists, because I'm very mindful of our time, a chance to respond. And I think we'll just start with Paul and just work the way down. Has NATO been marginalized? The role of energy, the role of the Orthodox Church, wisdom of NATO expansion, according to Russia, can we move beyond zero-sum thinking and sanctions policy? It actually harms the democracies that are pushing forward the sanctions. So fire away at anything you'd like to fire away at. Thanks, Paul.
I was going to focus on the first one, on the energy question. Very briefly, the question was Europe less dependent on, you know, how to get Europe less dependent on Russian gas. And I'd say very simply, first of all, the importance of a political decision in this. In the United States, I think that we have become very diversified in terms of our energy. We've experienced, obviously, a energy boom, which has ramifications for the kinds of policies which, in fact, we're pursuing. But it is and has to be a political decision taken in Europe by the various countries about it's in their interest. Moving aside the current events of the day, let's say if we were all sitting here and we were not discussing, you know, what happened in and has happened in Ukraine, I would still make the same case to you. In other words, it is in Europe's interest, period, in having a more diversified energy approach. And what does that mean? One of the most practical things is these kinds of things can't be done overnight because they require a certain change, a modernization, a shift in emphasis, and every country's different in terms of what it gets as its energy sources. But simply put, the United States obviously has liquefied natural gas, and in working with Europe, I think there are targeted approaches, certain percentages of exports that we could render into Europe for consideration. And last point I'd make, energy is very critical here because 2 points, Russia is heavily dependent. When you look eastward for Russia, it doesn't have the same kind of structural capacity that it does westward. And so any changes in terms of Europe and any kind of cutting off certainly will very much directly impact Russia's economy. And secondly, there has been creative thinking in Europe. Slovakia came forward recently with this reverse flow proposal to get gas into Ukraine. which is a creative proposal. It will help Ukraine in just a short term, only for a few months, but everything matters. So bottom line is, it's a political decision. There has to be political will. I think that regardless of the situation on the ground, it's in Europe's interest to become more energy diversified. I'll just stop there for the moment.
On NATO extension, is it a danger or a pretext for repositioning, if I understand your question? In a way, for the security community, military community, it is a danger. And the story in Russia, history already, which is enshrined into the textbooks, is that Mr. Gorbachev was promised when he managed to help with the reunification of Germany, he was promised that not a single soldier or military installation of NATO would be further than the dividing line of Berlin. Now, NATO commanders tell us that there is no such signed document. I once asked Mr. Gorbachev to tell me personally whether it's true or not. And he said, yes, it's true, but how can I sign anything with the living Honecker, with all of my comrades in the socialist bloc still alive and still at the top of their governments? I had an oral confirmation and reiteration of this confirmation by Kohl and American leadership that, yes, if I'm instrumental in reunification, which was contrary to Mr. Thatcher and Mr. Mitterrand's wishes, then there will be no NATO advancement. I was present at the conversation with Mr. Solana, who was the General Secretary of NATO at that time in 1993 in Moscow, who confirmed that. Yes, it was oral, but how can I base myself on oral when people want NATO, first of all, NATO enlargement, second, NATO installations advancement. But having said all of this, it's true, we feel a little bit misguided by the behavior of our colleagues in the West from this point of view. But in 2007, 2011, when I worked for President Medvedev, I thought, and we made it as a think tankers, we made it absolutely clear to him that it's, at that particular moment, it was more of a pretext than a danger, showing exactly what you tell us, the behavior of some of the neophytes of NATO, like Czech Republic, Slovakia, and Poland, less so Estonia, because the upbeat and very proud president of Estonia, Mr. Ilves, always poked the Baron into the eye, including two, I think, fighters F-17, which are positioned someplace in the Baltic Sea, and all of that stuff. But for the rest of it, we were telling the president, trying to convince him to come to Lisbon summit in 2010, I mean NATO summit, that it's more of a pretext than a real danger. And he bought the arguments. He went to Lisbon in spite of a very serious pressure on him not to go. And I was very pleased to be part of Mrs. Albright team on strategic rethinking of NATO concept. I was invited as a visiting expert sort of to this thing, and we discussed many interesting issues. And in NATO, in Lisbon in 2010, Mr. Medvedev made a very good deal with NATO, which excluded Russia out of the threats, which included into the potential partners, and he brought this element back to Russia. Everything went sour after Libya. That I can tell you. After Libyan crisis, when instead of the open skies, NATO started operation, it was not NATO, but two countries supported by the United States from behind. But then all of our efforts, when we persuaded Medvedev to pass this resolution by abstaining, he faced a criticism which you wouldn't believe, saying that now we know how you are duped by NATO, Mr. Medvedev. I wouldn't say that it was the reason why Putin staged his comeback, but that was one of the elements of that. So I leave it at that.
Yes, sir.
On NATO importance, it is a highly charged situation and conflict with a lot of emotions. And people would behave much more emotionally and less responsibly if we were not in NATO. So in Poland, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, emotions would be much, much higher. We now understand what was meant by Chancellor Kohl when he said that knowing that Germany is in NATO helps him to sleep better. So this is the situation. On religion, I don't think so, sir. There is a distinctly different cultural heritage in these two parts of Ukraine. Religion is certainly one of its elements, but it is not a distinction, there is no more a distinction between Catholic and Protestant world. Greece, Bulgaria, Romania, are in European Union. Serbia is joining European Union. These are very important Orthodox countries, and it's not the Orthodox versus Catholics. On transactional and other, of course, if you do, if you implement. Policies and actions that you believe are imperative because of your history, because of your responsibility to the history, numbers don't matter. But once you stopped and think about it and others come to you and talk to you, numbers do matter this nowadays. We were talking today that numbers matter even much more today than in 1945 or at the beginning of the Cold War. So trade relations, it is about trade relations, about sanctions, about restraint of private sector. That happens regardless of official sanctions. This is the situation that we're seeing today with Russia. We can read in Financial Times almost daily about the company's decisions to wait with their investment or trade decisions because of the situation. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, please give us the benediction.
I'll just make two points on this NATO issue. One is a question of fact. There are two different versions of what was understood. There's no doubt that on the Russian side, Mr. Gorbachev had a different impression of what he was being told. On the U.S. side, the Secretary of State at the time, Mr. Baker, explicitly says that what we told the Russian side is that NATO forces will not move east if Germany is reunified, and it was specifically addressed to the question of Germany, because at that time no one was contemplating an overall upheaval in Eastern Europe in which countries, members of the Warsaw Pact, would become totally free and able to make their own decisions. I think there is, I think there may be a legitimate disagreement of interpretation rather than some willful deception. In any case, it is kind of interesting that on an issue of such enormous strategic importance, this Russian side, the Soviet side, did not insist on a written commitment, if that was really so central to it. And I think the reason is that events were assuming a dynamic of their own, and it was clear that the process of change would not stop, whatever it said. So I think it's one of those retroactive arguments which really don't tell us very much. But in any case, it tells us something negative. There was no deliberate deception. And the flight into the NATO agreement from the Warsaw Pact developed subsequently in the course of several years. There is a larger question. Let's assume that there was an agreement, and Latvia, Estonia, Lithuania, Poland, Romania, Bulgaria were not in NATO right now. would the Ukrainian problem be easier to address, or would it be the beginning, really, of an all-European war? I think it's quite clear. You know, in international politics, as in neighborhoods, strong fences make for better neighbors. It's better to have some barbed wire supporting and dividing some countries. It's just common sense. So I don't think, again, that's a very relevant argument. The fact of the matter is that historically, particularly the Baltic countries, also Poland, to some extent Romania, have had experience with Russia, which was not all that delightful for them, and they have rather unfavorable memories of it. And it's only natural for them to be part of a larger European entity with which they can identify. But to the extent that I can gauge, I don't have a sense they view it as an exclusive proposition. This is what they really would like in the longer run, Ukraine and Russia to be part of it. But Russia to be part of it has to be a genuine democracy. And that, incidentally, wasn't mentioned in the earlier discussion. And Russia in recent years, sadly, and in my judgment, because I'm an optimist, only temporarily, is moving towards a kind of nationalistic dictatorship, which makes it altogether clear why it wouldn't have been in the interest of the Central European countries not to be today in NATO.
Well, all I can say is what a privilege it has been for the last hour and a half to listen to these insights wrestling with today's most challenging crises. We look forward to the report. Paula, we're holding you to it, early May. But again, please join me in thanking our panelists for a wonderful discussion.